workshop on bringing together games and political science. My name is Josh Franco. I'm a professor of political science at Cuyamaca College in East San Diego County. So this workshop is a series that explores how games relate to concepts in political science. I'll be live streaming a variety of games and discussing how different elements of the game can relate to political science. These workshops are live streamed on Twitch on Wednesdays, so now from 7:30 to 8, and you can go to poliventure.com to watch the live stream or watch it on Twitch, so whatever works best for you. This is our schedule for the fall semester, so we started a few weeks ago in the middle of October and introduced the seven concepts, and week by week we've been examining one by one, so communication, information, strategy, and now this week is moves. The following week will be network, and then we'll take a break for Thanksgiving, and then we'll come back with our last two workshops on probability and signals. If you're interested, you can watch the summer recordings. They're on the website, and this was like the testing of this concept of a workshop for students, and so I was glad that folks enjoyed it and obviously brought it back for the second half of fall. And again, you can watch the live stream on Twitch, or you can go to polyventure.com, which has an embedded live stream there. All right, so let me go ahead and collapse all these sections and get us to week five, moves. So our learning objectives with this workshop are the following. First is to, by the end of this workshop, you should be able to define moves. Secondly is explain how moves occur in a game. And then secondly, explain how moves occur with a real life political example. Now recall that we have seven concepts that we're examining with this workshop. So we have communication, information, strategy, moves, network, probability, and signals. And so the reason I chose these concepts is because I feel they're pretty prevalent in political science. Imagine these as seeds of ideas or seeds of concepts that we slowly build upon here. And as you continue on in political science, assuming it's your major, you'll dig more deeper into these concepts and how they're operationalized in the real world, how we measure them, and what they mean both in an academic sense but in a real life sense. Obviously, there's more concepts. There's a really broad universe of them, but I decided to focus on these for this go-around of the workshop. So the concept in focus for tonight is moves, and moves can be categorized into two buckets. The first one is simultaneous, where you move at the same time as other players. And the second one is sequential, where you take turns with other players to move. And so the idea is, like, how can we operationalize the concept with the game of both simultaneous and sequential? I'm going to go ahead and focus on this, on the simultaneous moving of games. And we're going to go ahead and check out the game Subnautica Below Zero. I decided on this one because it seemed pretty cool. There's like these sea creatures, and it's like a first-person game, so get to explore the worlds that you're in. And then we'll explore some examples in real life, both sequential and simultaneous. But with that, let's go ahead and get to our game, Subnautica. This is the menu. Let me go ahead and turn on the music now, since I had to lower the volume as I do this part. And the audio should be there. I'll raise it just a little bit more. It's 40. Maybe 50. Okay, so let's go ahead and play. We'll just start a new game. Let's see, I'll go this survival mode. Let's go ahead and check this out. It's pretty nice graphics that I see here. Concept art. Looks like a spaceship. Looks like some kind of bee-looking item over here. Or bee ship. And meteors crashing down on some other world, which seems pretty cool. Progress bar moving along. My video's in front of it, so it's kind of hard to see, but now you see this little creature. Looks like a penguin, but it's certainly not. So the world is loading as we speak. All right, here we go.
This is the farthest that I can take you on company space bucks, Robin. You sure you want this? The research isn't everything.
It is to me, and Sam. I need to know what happened.
The meteor storm.
I can use it for cover from Altera's eyes.
Gonna miss you, Robin.
I'll find my way back.
Approaching 4546 speed. Surface temperature is... Drop pod deployed.
Oh, it looks like we're entering the atmosphere of this planet. And a really robust crash landing. Let's see, do I have to do anything still? Not yet. So right now the game is setting it up, so it's automated here. Escape pod. Alright, looks like we can roll.
Welcome to 4546 speed. Enjoy your stay.
So this is a real-time game just because I'm moving at the same time as other things are moving. So right now there's not this many other players for this adventure.
That did not go as planned.
That looks like a radiating flower.
I should find a way into the water and get to the drop pod.
Alright. I gotta go check out this drop pod. These weird plants and things. Oh. He's gonna... It's like I pass that glowing flower and it like radiates. Pretty cool. I suppose I'm looking for something. She said we're gonna go for the drop pod. Okay, there it is. Just jump in the water. Let's see. I thought I saw some fish. So nothing too much to worry about here. There doesn't seem to be any kind of antagonistic kind of creatures. So normally when we think of moves, right, we think and either they're simultaneous or they are sequential. This is certainly not a sequential game. It's not like I have to take my turn and then wait for something else to take its turn and then kind of go down the list like you would see in a game like Settlers of Catan or Civilization.
Found the drop pod.
Okay, I'm in the drop pod. I don't know, what do I fabricate? Definitely give me some fins. Should I take fins? Compass helps. So what do I do here? Move my window over just a little bit because this gets cut off. So it looks like there's just like a range of tools I can collect, which is pretty interesting. I guess I gotta go collect stuff. So I thought there'd be a little bit more action at the beginning part. That's why I'm kind of like at a slightly at a loss. Just kind of happens. I'm not going to worry too much about it. Go ahead and keep exploring. Oh, there's storage here. So I have all this material, like blueprints, I guess. Tabbed.
Well, Sam, I guess I might as well gather some tools and resources before starting my search. Hope that radio tower is as easy to spot as Lil said.
Okay. I guess the question is, what am I looking for? Go above water. So you can see I have an oxygen meter. Well, I'm kind of covering it, but gotta breathe air. Whoa. It's a pretty icy world. I was kind of hoping to come up across some kind of, like, you know, non-player controlled unit or, you know, something that would demonstrate this simultaneous moves kind of logic that I was hoping for. And I didn't want to play like a first-person shooter like Counter-Strike or something. I feel like there's a little too much for what I'm going for here.
Dangerous weather approaching. Seek shelter.
Alright, where am I supposed to go? Guess I'll go back through this cave. Or this canyon, I should say. Interesting. So these flowers kind of like warm me up. Huh. So I'm going to do this for about a few more minutes, see what I can find. Here's my old ship. I'm going to throw some snowballs at it because why not? I guess I'll keep exploring, see what's going on here. I mean, this looks like a resource I need, but it's not. Over here. This looks like a cave. Nope. Just, it's a dead end. Well, in any case, what I was hoping for was that there might be some units that might be trying to, like, follow me or, like, being a little aggressive, and then I would have to, like, outmaneuver them or, in this case, throw a few snowballs at them. You know, something that would just show that there are simultaneous moves happening, because I am moving as the other person is. All right, so you hear this radiating. It's like warm flowers. So this is, all right, so I'll use this as an example because it's the closest thing I'm getting to what I want. So here I'm cooling off. Right now you can't see it because it's behind my video screen, but my temperature is declining rapidly. Started at 100, now it's at 80, and it's just going down probably by every half second. So I'm going to reach a cold point. I'm just going to let this happen until I get an alert. And then once that alert goes, the idea is, like, the simultaneous moves are happening between me and the weather. And so the weather is cooling me off, and I need to stay warm. And there are units around to do that. And you can see me, I'm shaking, you know, putting my hands together. So I'm going to go ahead and say, okay, well, I have to respond to this dynamic weather environment.
Hypothermia imminent.
And then one way I can do that is by getting next to these very hot flowers. And now I'm back and warmed up. So in this case, the simultaneous move is me having to respond to the very chilly environment. Okay, so let me go ahead and end this for now. Yeah, sure. I would obviously spend a lot more time on this game to kind of get to another example of it, but I'll run with what I got. Okay, so we got that game checked out. It's pretty cool at the upfront parts. We need to obviously spend more than 9 minutes on it just to demonstrate it. But let's go ahead and take a look at some real life examples or concepts of sequential and simultaneous moves. So
I'll first share this article, or actually this press release by the United States Department of State. And this is a joint statement by the governments of the United States and the and of China on addressing the climate crisis. So we're going to go ahead and let this load. I'll bring it in right here. And let me go ahead and close the game window. So here we see that this is a joint statement, which would suggest a simultaneous move because it's happening at the same time between two very important political players when it comes to climate change. So I'm going to go ahead and play these, or have this read to us, these first few sentences.
U.S. Special Presidential Envoy for Climate John Kerry and China Special Envoy for Climate Change Xi Jinping met in Shanghai on April the 15th and 16th, 2021, to discuss aspects of the climate crisis. At the conclusion of the discussion, the two special envoys released the following joint statement. Begin text. The United States and China are committed to cooperating with each other and with other countries to tackle the climate crisis, which must be addressed with the seriousness and urgency that it demands. This includes processes, including the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change and the Paris Agreement. Both countries recall their historic contribution to the development, adoption, signature, and entry into force of the Paris Agreement through their leadership and collaboration. Moving forward, the United States and China are firmly committed to working together and with other parties to strengthen implementation of the Paris Agreement. The two sides recall the agreement's aim in accordance with Article 2 to hold the global average temperature increase to well below 2 degrees Celsius and to pursue efforts to limit it to 1.5 degrees Celsius. In that regard, they are committed to pursuing such efforts, including by taking enhanced climate actions that raise ambition in the 2020s in the context of the Paris Agreement, with the aim of keeping the above temperature limit within reach and cooperating to identify and address related challenges and opportunities. Both countries look forward to the U.S.-hosted Leaders' Summit on Climate on April 22nd and 23rd. They share the summit's goal of raising global climate ambition on mitigation, adaptation, and support on the road to COP26 in Glasgow.
And so the statement goes on to describe, you know, what actions each of the governments will take and basically how they're going to work together. So this is a great example of simultaneous moves where two countries that have a very high impact and high stakes in the future of the world's climate are moving at the same time. And in this case, demonstrating that movement at the same time by having a joint statement. So I'm pretty sure that every aspect of this joint statement was very carefully debated, discussed, deliberated between those two envoys and their staffs and their governments, and then eventually was released out to the public. So in political science and in politics, you'll see examples of simultaneous moves of joint statements, joint actions, joint ventures, joint military movements and the like between country governments and other organizations. So this is a prime example of that. Now, an example of sequential moving is a recent ruling by a district court or a federal district court judge on a request by former President Trump to withhold records that are now in the possession of the National Archive from being submitted to Congress based on a request from Congress. So let me go ahead and open up this article and we'll have this read out a little bit to us. And obviously the article is Swift Ruling Test Trump's Tactic of Running Out the Clock. All right, so let's go ahead and have this read to us here. Yeah, it should be good enough there.
Washington, on the surface, a judge's ruling on Tuesday night that Congress can obtain Trump White House files related to January 6th riot seemed to echo another high-profile ruling in November 2019. In the earlier matter, a judge said a former White House counsel must testify about then-President Donald J. Trump's efforts to obstruct the Russia investigation. In both cases, Democratic-controlled House oversight committees issued subpoenas. Mr. Trump sought to stonewall those efforts by invoking constitutional secrecy powers, and Obama-appointed federal district court judges, to liberal cheers, ruled against him. Each ruling even made the same catchy declaration, presidents are not kings. But there was a big difference. The White House counsel case 2 years ago had chewed up 3.5 months by the time Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson issued a 120-page opinion to end its first stage. Just 23 days elapsed between Mr. Trump's filing of January 6 papers lawsuit and Judge Tanya Chutkan's ruling against him. The case, which raises novel issues about the scope of executive privilege when asserted by a former president, is not over. Mr. Trump is asking an appeals court to overturn Judge Chutkan's ruling and, in the interim, to block the National Archives from giving Congress the first set of files on Friday. The litigation appears destined to reach the Supreme Court, which Mr. Trump reshaped with three appointments. But if the rapid pace set by Judge Chutkan continues, it would mark a significant change from how lawsuits over congressional subpoenas went during the Trump era. The slow pace of such litigation worked to the clear advantage of Mr. Trump, who vowed to defy all congressional oversight subpoenas after Democrats took the House in the 2018 midterm. He frequently lost in court, but only after delays that ran out the clock on any chance that such efforts would uncover information before the 2020 election.
So you hear in this article about how there's this back and forth between, they're giving an example of when Mr. Trump was president, and now they're showing how when he's not president, how the courts are working. And so when you think of the political actors involved, it's Congress, it's the courts, and it's the President Trump at the time. And then now, fast forward to today, it's Congress and the courts and the former president. And what they're trying to point out here is that there's a set of moves being played by these actors. So, for example, Congress is asking the executive branch or an executive branch agency for records from the time when President Trump was in office. And there's a process by which the executive branch will review that request and then either fulfill it or not. And as they're reviewing and attempting to fulfill that request, the former president then sues in federal courts to say this shouldn't be allowed. So now the courts have to hear a case, and this was heard last week. The lawyers for former President Trump and the lawyers for the Congress argue before a judge saying, we need this information because, and then they're arguing, well, they shouldn't get this information because, and it's just back and forth, back and forth. So there's a sequence of moves here. And then everyone's kind of waiting for the court to issue their ruling. And then once they do issue their ruling, it explains the reasoning of the court to side, in this case, with Congress, and essentially arguing, among other things, that if the current executive in office, in this case, President Biden, is okay with providing this information from the executive branch to the legislative branch, well, then that's for them to figure out. It's not the province of the court, of the judicial branch, to get in the middle of those two branches interacting with each other based in the context of the Constitution and of the law. And so what we have here is a series of moves that happen sequentially. And now that the federal court has said that President Biden and can give the records to Congress, that it's done on their end. But what's going to happen, if it hasn't already, is that President Trump, Trump's lawyers, or former President Trump's lawyers, will ask the second level of the courts for a stay on the order and to have a hearing to appeal it. And depending on their action, it'll either go to that appeals court and they'll deliberate it. So this is the next step in the sequence. And if they overlook it, deny it, then the former president's lawyers can then go to the Supreme Court and say, hey, we need you to take action on this because of how important it is to us. So we'll see how this all plays out. But the whole idea is that when you have moves in politics, in most instances, they're sequential. Somebody moves first, and then somebody moves second, and then somebody moves third, and so on. It's not as common for moves to be done simultaneously. So like in the game that we're playing, obviously it's Sub-Zero Nautica. It's like, obviously it's cold, and my player needs to stay warm, and they know this, right? So cold weather, then I move towards a hot flower, and I warm back up. That's can be viewed sequentially, but it's happening simultaneously because you're getting cold and you need to make a reaction to it. Most of the times in politics, people will see the other side, the opponent move, and then they'll move next, and just kind of back and forth, back and forth. And if you're a close observer of these things, then you'll notice that it's not simultaneous, but it's sequential. So it just depends on how you want to look at it. So overall, when we think of moves, and we think about them in the sense of simultaneous and sequential, if you break it down enough,
it can be viewed as everything sequential. It's just that it might happen so quickly that it appears simultaneous. When we're playing regular computer games, like, obviously it looks simultaneous. Like, if I'm moving my tanks forward and then my opponent's moving their tanks forward, then we're kind of interacting with each other at the same time. But in politics, most things are sequential just because actors aren't reacting to each other so fast that it seems like a blur or seems simultaneous. So hopefully that gives you some insight into moves. Appreciate you taking the time. If there's any questions, I think they'll be in the chat. So let me just leave I'm not sure if anyone's watching any questions. And we'll give that a moment to see if anyone wants to ask a question. Because I know Matt's joined us. So thanks, Matt, for joining us. Appreciate it. It doesn't look like we have any questions. So with that, I appreciate you taking the time to watch this live stream. Hopefully next time when I choose a game, there's a little more dynamicism involved. But, you know, we kind of live and learn from these things. And Matt, thanks for your question. I'm doing well. So you know where to reach me. We can talk offline. But thanks again for watching. And for those of you watching the recording, I appreciate it. Well, take care and have a great evening.